look, I mentioned that, you know, there are real challenges in neuroscience drug discovery, which really need to become overcome to get drugs faster to the market, given the burden of neurological, psychiatric, brain disorders in the broadest sense. And one of the solutions we believe and we hope is going to be using iPSC cells. These are human-derived cells. You can drive them down different phenotypes. You can make them into neurons, microglia, astrocytes, oligodendrocytes, all those cells that occur and interplay in the brain. And why are they important? Because now you're using a human cell. This is a human physiological cell. It has all the components of a human cell, the pathways, the molecular components, all the different elements. So you're now in the in a system, in a cell type, which is the species ultimately you want to treat for disease. But it goes one step further than that. So you can actually use human iPSC cells that you've got from patients carrying who have disease. So for example, you can have a patient who has a genetic mutation that leads to disease. And if you take their cells, their skin cells or their blood cells, and reprogram them into neurons or astrocytes or microglia, you're now testing in a pathophysiological context. So you've got a cell from, let's say, a Huntington's patient, and you know what's gone wrong in that cell because of the genetics of Huntington's. In this case, you're actually screening your drugs in that cell type. So that's really, really a powerful tool. And the hope is that that will lead to improved translation to the clinic. And I'd like to just give one example of a program I was, you know, affiliated with at a previous big pharma company. And this is patients who have a rare disorder called erythromelalgia. And it's an amazing program. They took the cells from those patients and they turned them into nerves. They reprogrammed the iPSC cells into nerves. They tested the same drug they were testing in the patients in the clinic in the cells as well. And they were looking at, you know, various different endpoints. In this case, it was electrical activity in the nerves, in the dish, using these iPSC-derived neurons. And they saw an effect of the drug. In this case, it was an ion channel blocker that dampened electrical activity. And then when they did the clinical trial as well, they saw that actually some of the patients whose cells responded to the drug were also responding in terms of reduced burden, in this case, of neuropathic pain symptoms. I mean, I think that's a really, really powerful way of doing a clinical trial in the dish, if you like. Now, it's not straightforward. Nothing in science goes in a straight line. Many things in life don't go in a straight line. Certainly science doesn't. But if you can take that example and now scale it, can you now do this on a bigger scale? Can you screen compounds on iPSC cells in a more prospective way rather than what I described there with erythromelalgia patients, which is really was retrospective. It was doing a clinical trial in a dish, but at the same time, the patients were being treated in the clinic as well. But what if you do this in a prospective way? So you screen drugs against iPS-derived neurons or microglia, or whichever brain cell type, to look for drugs that are working in a cellular context, which is human-specific. Now, to do that, it takes time and it takes effort, and you need dedicated scientists, discovery scientists, who use modern lab automation techniques and processes so that you can reduce errors, variability in the workflows, and so you can really be, you can sit on a bunch of data which is credible, validated, robust, and is reproducible as well, and ultimately allows you to make effective decisions as well.